a firsthand mission report with some pictures from Heather, and I will let her share now.
Thank you for letting me share this story with you today. As a kid, I always would go to summer camp, not Camp Polaris, but summer camp in Alaska. And so my dream as a kid was to become a camp counselor when I was old enough. So these last two summers, I have been a camp counselor at Alaska camps. And one of the camps we go to is Camp Polaris. It is on a lake next to the town of Dillingham. Dillingham is a fishing town on the Bering Sea. It's a very neat place, and I'm just going to tell you a little bit of the story of what camp is like. So it's a very beautiful place to go, but first you have to get there. So we fly to this tiny, you have to fly there. So we fly to this tiny little airport, and we have, with Alaska camps, let me explain a little bit. We have three camps that we run with the same staff, and we just pick up the whole staff. Everything that we need to run a camp, we pick it up and move it to the next location. And then we do camp there for a week, and we pick it up and move it to the next location. So this means that we have to have a lot of stuff with us. So the bottom picture is a picture of us with our huge pile of stuff that we bring through the airport. We ride in a little red bus from Dillingham out to the lake. So this story is really a story about beautiful places, but it's more about beautiful people. Oh goodness. Can we go back a few? How does it go back? There, right there. Sorry, I haven't used one of these for a projector. So the map is a picture of all the lakes that are right next to Dillingham. I was looking at the map that you have out in the foyer, and it shows, of course, you know, has Alaska. If you look in the bottom left part of the map of Alaska, you see this little bit of lakes. There's like a couple lakes inland, just a little bit. And this is a close-up picture of those lakes. And right next to my hand on the picture is a lake called Lake Ueeck, and Dillingham is right next to Lake Ueeck. So once we get all of our stuff out of the bus on the beach, we have to pack it into these teeny little boats and go across the lake. It's like an hour and a half ride in these boats across like 8 miles, I think, on a boat. And it takes like three or four trips because we have so much stuff. So you can see from the top picture, we pile the boats really high, and you have to drive them really slow to keep from losing all the stuff. And I call these miracle boats because the people at camp do incredible things with the boats. The bottom picture has a picture of a piano on the boat. We had helped to clean out one of the churches that was across the lake. You can kind of see the buildings in the background of that bottom picture. There was a church there, and it wasn't being used anymore, so we had to take the piano out of the church to take it to a church member's house. And we had to take it apart, put it on the back of a four-wheeler, take it down to the lake, and then we put it in the boat and took it across the lake in the boat. So these boats and the people who drive them are really pretty incredible. After the boat ride is when we finally get to camp. This is a picture of camp from the water, and oftentimes we have friends that meet us there that are not quite so friendly. This camp serves a lot of different people. Most of the children are Native Americans or Native Alaskans. So the culture of Alaska is different, but then this particular village has its own culture also. It was kind of neat. The top picture, one of the families came out, they just flew their plane out to camp to visit one of their campers on Sabbath afternoon. It was just like everything was normal. They get a lot of rain there, so that's what the raincoats are. It's also an interesting experience because we have a lot of animals. The little animal is a ground squirrel, and they run around camp all the time. The kids love to chase them. The big one on the bottom is obviously a bear. Last year we had a bear come through camp just about every day that the campers were there. And that's always stressful because you never know what they're going to do. So I want to share a little bit about what a day at Polaris is like. First, the campers get there. They come on boats. And then once they get there, the camp staff sort them into cabins, just like at any other summer camp. So the large picture is a picture of me with my camp cabin this past year. First thing in the morning, the favorite thing to do is polar dipping. As soon as you wake up, you put on your swim trunks or your swimsuit and you run out into the lake, and this water is freezing, but somehow the kids love it. And they try to convince us to polar dip with them. It's a great way to wake up in the morning, though. You aren't asleep after that anymore. And often the cabin who had the most people that went polar dipping gets to go first in breakfast line, so there's incentive. After polar dipping and warming up after polar dipping, we have line call and then we go to breakfast. After breakfast, we have to do dishes, and we have wash basins outside that we wash the dishes in. And after we do dishes, all the cabins have their camp duties that they have to do. They clean the bathrooms, empty the trash. Well, the bathrooms are, that's a loose term, it's an outhouse. And you know, the kids collect firewood and do all sorts of things. The next thing, which is one of the favorites, is worship. On the nice days when it's not raining, we have worship outside in the tent. And the kids love to sing, and they always sing the same songs every day. And we get tired of playing them, but we play them again because the kids just, they love singing so much. They love singing their favorite camp songs about Jesus and his love. Then there's always a spiritual thought before the day begins. The next thing that goes on is the classes. The kids love doing activities, so we have activities that they get to sign up for. The top one on the left is knot tying. And then they also do tie-dye and cake decorating, and they do all sorts of crafts. They do archery, they do canoeing and swimming and water skiing in the cold water. It's quite the adventure. The other favorite thing to do is to gather around the campfire, especially when you're cold and wet after being in the lake. There's nothing quite like a fire. The kids love the water. Any chance that they get, can we please go swimming? Can we please go swimming? I think the favorite thing, though, is tubing. They get, they're small boats that we go behind, but we manage to get the kids in the boat and we put them on the tubes, and they just love riding around. It's always a war between the kids and the boat driver to see who wins, because the boat driver always wants to have the kids fall off. The kids hold on for dear life. They also go kneeboarding and wakeboarding and swimming and just exploring in the lake. One of the most special times at camp is Sabbath afternoon. This picture is when we had church outside. Everyone just was sitting on the benches. We sang songs, and we had a wonderful sermon by the chaplain who we had. Sabbath afternoon, we take a hike up the mountain behind camp, and even the little kids make it all the way up. My mom was at camp with me one of the years that I was a counselor. And the little girl on the right she didn't want to hike up the mountain. And my mom was, okay, I don't want to hike up the mountain either. We can stay at camp. But then one of the other camp counselors told the little girl, you know, up at the top they have candy for the people who make it to the top. So then the little girl decided, oh, well, I want to go to the top now. So this little girl dragged my mom all the way up the mountain so they could have candy. And it worked. Now, this is one of the most unique parts about Camp Polaris. We don't have bathrooms or showers. So for showering, for cleaning ourselves, we have to use the steam house. And I was going to try to put the native word, but I realized I have no idea how to spell it. And finally this year, they told me that I do actually know how to pronounce it, so I hope I don't slaughter it this time. It's called a maque. And the way that you clean yourself is by getting it really hot and you pour water over yourself, and then you go and you run into the lake and rinse off, then you go back inside and get some more clean water, then you run back into the lake. It's like hydrotherapy. It's hot and cold, hot and cold. That's quite the experience. I'm going to tell you a little bit about some of the improvements that are happening at camp. The large picture is a picture of the dock that we used to have, and also the picture on the top, the one that says the old is gone. That's the old dock, and apparently the fish were eating the dock because it had foam blocks underneath it, and the fish were eating the foam, and it was killing them. And they would, you know, when their foam is in their bellies, it kills them. So we got rid of the old dock, and we are working on getting a new dock. You can see the blue barrels in the bottom picture. Those are going to be the floating part of the dock that will keep the dock floating, and it won't kill the fish because they can't eat 55-gallon drums. This is a picture of some of the buildings at camp, and I think the bottom one is the craft shed, but the most interesting one is the storage containers. Since we have bears and ground squirrels at camp, we can't leave food just in the lodge or outside or in a normal shed. So we have storage containers. The one on the left is called Fred Meyer's, and the other one is called Costco. And you can kind of tell, like, oh, go to Fred Meyer's. That's the one where you get all your groceries. And so that's where the refrigerators are. Costco is the one where all the dry food is. This camp has been around for quite a few years. And so the bottom picture of this on this slide is of the old cabins, the little red building. It's made out of 2x4s and plywood, so it's not very sturdy. They're the old cabins. And then the big picture is called the bear-proof cabin. So all the counselors always try to get the bear-proof cabin because being in the non-bear-proof cabin just isn't a good idea. But something interesting that happened was kind of sad. This past winter, the girls' non-bear-proof cabin blew over. So these are pictures of what used to be the cabin. On the top over there is the place where it had been. Then the other pictures is of the broken pieces that were left on the beach. The bottom picture over there is of the bed springs that the kids used to sleep on. One of the projects for the Sabbath school offering is mattresses for these kids. A lot of them just sleep on cardboard on these box springs. Or not box springs, but on the springs. So they never complain. They love being at camp, even though it isn't necessarily the most comfortable when you sleep, but they still love being there. But it will be such a blessing for them to have mattresses. So like the slide says, I've lived in Alaska all my life, and Camp Polaris is the most isolated place that I've ever been. You're out in the middle of nowhere, no communication with the outside world at all, but that's also the place where I feel closest to God. And the neat thing about camp is that it gives those kids out there who may not have had a chance to know God, it gives them a chance to learn about him too. So camp is really a story about beautiful places, but more importantly, it's about beautiful people. Thank you.
Thank you, Heather. That was neat. And the story you'll find is, once you get into the Proverbs, is the end of January 30, which is right near Heather's birthday. She'll turn 20. So thank you, Heather, and happy Sabbath.
Good morning. It's good to see you all here today. It's nice to see the pews filled up. Guess if we keep the weather bad enough, you guys will all stay home, right? So we'll get more people. Just want to welcome everybody here today, especially Nathan. It's good to have him home. I haven't been told of any pertinent announcements, but announcements are in our bulletin board, bulletin and out on the bulletin board, trying to put more out there as well. So I just want to bring everybody the Thanksgiving thought that, you know, someday what will that Thanksgiving in heaven be like? You know, where family gets together for real. It's kind of something to think about this week. So, well, I guess we'll begin our service, and if you would bow your heads as we kneel in prayer.
For our opening hymn this morning, let's turn to page 596. Look for the waymarks, number 596. Little, please rise.
Look for the waymarks as you journey on. Look for the waymarks passing one by one, down through the ages, past the kingdom's door. Where are we standing? Look the waymarks o'er. Look for the waymarks, the great prophetic waymarks, down through the ages, past the kingdom's door. Look for the waymarks, the great prophetic waymarks, the journey's almost o'er. First the Assyrian kingdom ruled the world, then Medo Persia banners were unfurled, and after Greece held universal sway, Rome seized the scepter. Where are we today? Look for the waymarks, the great prophetic waymarks, down through the ages, past the kingdom's door. Look for the waymarks, the great prophetic waymarks, the journey's almost o'er. Down in the feet of iron and of clay, weak and divided, soon to pass away, what will the next great glorious drama be? Christ and his coming and eternity. Look for the waymarks, the great prophetic waymarks, down through the ages, past the kingdom's door. Look for the waymarks, the great prophetic waymarks, the journey's almost o'er.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the Sabbath day. We ask, Lord, that your Spirit would be here to guide us throughout this day. We know, Lord, that you desire us to grow closer to you. And we ask, Lord, that we would do just that. You have promised when we draw nigh to you, you will draw nigh to us. We claim that promise. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our offering this morning is, as you read in your bulletin, for the North American Division, what?